I think I still remember the protocols here for... Okay. Okay. Any questions?
When's the legislature coming back?
Yeah, so I am going to have that discussion with cabinet and caucus tomorrow, but we will be coming back in November, and we'll be announcing the date likely in the next couple of days.
So possibly following the calendar schedule that was already established, November 16th, coming back with the throne speech?
Yeah, I want to have that discussion with cabinet and caucus. There's certainly lots of things that we're going to be discussing over the course of the next little while, and that will be one of them. But we'll just see. Yeah.
Any changes to cabinet planned, or are you looking forward to the same cabinet?
So we'll go through all of that. I obviously want to have the chance to talk to cabinet and caucus first, and there will be changes eventually. But, you know, certainly I'm not of the mindset that we need to rush into that. I want to make sure that we get that right. And so I want to be discussing some of those things with my colleagues. I want to have the chance to sit down with each one of them individually as well and have their... and get their feedback, so we'll be doing that over the course of the next little while.
On Sunday, we heard that John Leach was replacing David McLaughlin. Why so fast? What was the rush? It just seemed like it was pretty sudden.
I actually think it's pretty normal for, you know, a new premier coming in to change things a bit, and certainly Don Leach has incredible experience. I've worked with him before in his days with the Business Council. He has extensive experience when it comes to, you know, public service. And so I'm really pleased to have him on board.
Do you have people in mind for principal secretary, chief of staff? Will you be making some announcements on that?
We'll be making announcements moving forward on that. Yep.
To totally change the topic, the test positivity rate is up. Southern Health, it's skyrocketing, probably to a level that would match our worst in the third wave in the entire province. What are you going to do now that you're the premier to bring the numbers down and get more people vaccinated? What is your plan?
Yeah, so obviously we'll continue to take the advice of the Chief Provincial Public Health Officer. You know, we want to ensure that we're out listening to Manitobans as well, who are negatively impacted as a result of closures and things like that. So we want to make sure that we're listening to those Manitobans. I think all Manitobans have been negatively impacted as a result of this pandemic, and we need to ensure that we put the health and safety of Manitobans first.
But on that note, if you look right now, we have 26% week-over-week growth. We keep going like this, mostly driven by Southern Health. We're going to be in 300-plus cases before the end of November.
Yeah, and I will get in front of Dr. Roos, and I will sit down with Brent and have those discussions, and I need a briefing from him, and we'll do that moving forward to see what the advice is on that end of things.
There's no dead way for me to ask this, but now that you're premier and you're not subordinate to a premier as health minister, are you going to be more aggressive on this?
So, I will listen to the Chief Provincial Public Health Officer. We'll take the advice, but we have to balance that with what this means about, you know, if it's looking at lockdowns and things like that. I don't want to be looking at that. And so we're going to take any measure we can to ensure that we remain open. We want to make sure that those businesses can remain open and running.
If you think there's divisions now, imagine what happens with people in Winnipeg where the test positivity rate and the infection rate is minuscule. How are we going to feel here if our hospitals are completely full of people from other regions where vax rates are lower? What would you do if we start having to see lockdowns everywhere because our hospitals are full again, not for people from the capital?
Well, I think, you know, we do have, you know, upwards of 86% who have taken, you know, a first vaccine dose, and I think percent of two doses. I think that is helping, but obviously we will look at this and I'll take the advice of the Chief Provincial Public Health Officer. We'll have discussions as a cabinet and caucus as to how we want to see things moving forward. I do take this very seriously, and I will seek that advice first before we act.
Thank you.
Normally, you seek that advice. When are you going to be meeting with?
So tomorrow we're meeting with cabinet and caucus tomorrow, but I do want a briefing as soon as possible with Dr. Rusin as well, and I believe our staff is in the process now of just setting up those meetings.
Manitobans expect to see differently from a government under your leadership when we're looking at pandemic, both healthcare and economic recovery, that we didn't see under your predecessors?
Well, I think I know I've been out all across this province in the last couple of months, actually, on the leadership race and listening to Manitobans. And I think that's important that we continue to do that moving forward. I don't think, you know, we should be making decisions after we're listening to Manitobans to see where we want to go with that. But obviously, when it comes to the public health orders, we want to ensure that we're protecting Manitobans first and ensuring that, you know, it doesn't have a negative impact on our hospital, you know, on our hospitals and our ICUs. So we'll continue to take that advice moving forward.
Shelley Glover says she should be the premier designate. She's filed this legal challenge that says there was some irregularities with the count on Saturday. I'd like your reaction to that, and are you concerned this could kind of hang over over your leadership?
I think it's really disappointing, you know, that they're taking that action. But you know what? I'm not going to get, focused on that moving forward. I think, you know, we're here. We're a government. We formed a government, and we're going to continue to listen to Manitobans. We want to ensure that, you know, we're going to tackle those healthcare backlogs, both surgical and diagnostic, and as well as, you know, just get our economy back up and running. These are the priorities that Manitobans want us to focus on, and so that's what we'll continue to focus on over the course of the next little while.
She just said, "I am the premier, not her."
So I haven't been watching what she's been doing today. I've been caught up in my own ceremony. Just so obviously just humbled to have been given the opportunity to be in this role, so we'll continue to represent Manitobans and ensure that we're out listening to Manitobans. And our focus absolutely has to be on governing, not getting involved in these other sort of situations that are happening out there.
Do you think there's any legitimacy to the issue she's raising about ballots that suddenly appeared on Saturday, and that there's some evidence, according to her, that there was a spreadsheet and that there is discrepancies between the numbers on Friday and Saturday? Do you think there's anything credible there? Do you think it should be looked at?
Well, I don't think, you know, I mean, certainly, you know, I don't know what would happen in the room and so on. All I know is that the party leadership who ran the leadership race came into the room and announced what the results were, and they talked extensively about the process and what had transpired, and it seemed to be very legitimate, and they made that known to all Manitobans. And so, you know, so I'm sitting here today. I had a very good meeting with the Lieutenant Governor yesterday and this morning, and so we'll continue to focus on what we need to focus on, and that's what's in the best interest of all Manitobans.
Did you talk with the Lieutenant Governor about this issue?
I'm not going to say what I talked to her about, but certainly, you know, we talked about a number of things, and we had a very great conversation about this wonderful province of ours.
On Saturday, you talked about unity. Obviously, what's happening right now that's not really what's happening. For people who are looking in to see Manitoba experience this right now, how are you going to put forward this unity when we have a lot of division happening right now?
Well, I do know that, I'm going to take the same approach that I have pretty much most of my political career life, and that is listening to Manitobans and listening to people within the party. If they've got challenges that they have, I want to hear from them, you know, good or bad. I will be out listening to Manitobans. I'll be listening to people within party, and I'm hoping that we can unite our party. This is what, obviously, I want to see moving forward, and I look forward to having those discussions.
Premier, you pride yourself on being conciliatory and listening to people and trying to get along with people and finding out where there's common ground. Have you reached out to Shelley Glover since Saturday?
I did. No, I did on Saturday, and I think, you know, I went over and gave her a hug, and I thought everything was fine. I said, let's unite our party together, and I was surprised by what happened after that. But I guess she announced that she was going to, whatever way she was going to go moving forward, that she was going to take that time to make her own decision, and so I respected that, and so, you know, that, so that's...
What's frustrating is that you're answering questions about this on the day that you're sworn in, that this is now starting to overshadow you being sworn in.
You know, again, I think it's disappointing, but I'm not going to let this get off our game and our focus that we need to maintain. You know, in this role, I need to look at what's in the best interest of all Manitobans, and that's what I'll continue to do. I'm going to meet tomorrow with Cabinet and Caucus and have these discussions about, you know, what are the next steps in ensuring that when it's with COVID, I mean, the safety of all Manitobans. You know, there's other priorities that I've already talked about in terms of healthcare and reducing the backlogs. And obviously getting our economy back up and running. These are the things that Manitobans want us to be focused on, and so I'll continue to be focused on those things.
Thank you. A reminder to our reporters on the phone. You will have one preliminary and one follow-up question. Up first from the Brandon Sun, Drew.
Thank you. Madam Premier, now that you're officially in the role and you're the Premier, what's your plan to reach out to Westman and other areas of the province outside the perimeter of Winnipeg?
Yeah, no, great question. I've obviously been out there several times in the last couple of months and indeed several times over the last number of years that I've been in elected office. I think it's very important that we get outside of Winnipeg and that we're looking and knowing and understanding what some of the challenges are in our Westman area. I will continue to work, you know, with certainly our MLAs out there, and ensure that we're listening to Manitobans to see what they want out of our government. So we'll continue to do that.
Thank you. And just on the same topic, I think it can be fairly said that from some of your predecessors, people in Westman have felt left out of the conversation. Will your approach to rural Manitoba and specifically the Brandon area change at all from Premier Palliser or his predecessors?
Well, I know certainly I have a good relationship with Mayor Crest, and we'll continue in the chamber there. We've met with many Manitobans out in Brandon and the Westman area, and we'll continue to take that approach. I'll take the approach that I always have, and that's to be out listening to Manitobans to see, you know, where we and what the priorities are of those in Westman to ensure that we're addressing those issues.
From CJOB, Skyler.
Hi, Madam Premier. I am quite certain right now there are quite a few demonstrators outside the legislature on behalf of the University of Manitoba Faculty Association. They've been calling for the government to take action on their ongoing wage talks with the university for a few days now. I know you're just an hour into this role. Is there any plan to speak to that to your caucus or cabinet?
Yeah, so certainly we want the process to move forward. That process is in place, and that's between the employer and the employees. And so we'll continue to ensure that we respect that process. And obviously we want to see a positive resolution for everyone involved. And so, you know, we'll continue to monitor that. And I know that I'm sure I will be getting briefings on this moving forward, and I'll seek the advice of, you know, Cabinet and so on. But we need to ensure that that process continues to move forward on its own and respect that process.
Okay. Thank you for that. I have no further questions.
From City News, Mike.
Yeah, good afternoon, Premier Stefanson. My first question, you spoke about advancing reconciliation. How will you go about this when current Indigenous leaders in Manitoba have been so vocal about damaged relations under the previous PC leadership?
Yeah, well, I think I have good relationships with our Grand Chiefs. I did have an opportunity to see them on Saturday. I know I've been in touch with President Chartrand as well. I also have other Indigenous groups, like our clan mothers, for example, that I mentioned in my in my speech today. You know, these are individuals that I want to continue to maintain a good relationship with, and I'm going to learn from them and hear from them and listen to them as to how we can help them heal through this process. And so I'll continue to maintain those positive relationships.
Thank you for that. And my follow-up question, will you meet with Mayor Brian Bowman, and when? Because he has been vocal about having a tough time meeting with PC leadership in the past.
I'll be happy to meet with Mayor Bowman, and I know we'll be in touch with him very shortly to set that up.
From the Neepawa Banner and Press, Ken.
Good afternoon, Ms. Stefanson. Congratulations on your appointment today. It's a prestigious day for the province and for yourself. And my question would be, first question would be, what is your message to the 49% of the voters that voted for Ms. Glover? What's your message to them today?
Well, my message is that we need to find a way. We're going to find some common ground in all of this so that we can move forward and unite our party. And we'll do that. I know I'm going to work very closely with my colleagues to ensure that we are reaching out to people in all areas of this province, and to ensure that we are listening to them and bringing people together and uniting them.
As a follow-up to that, it's with the pandemic having held us all back from doing many things for nearly 2 years now, do you anticipate a date when the PC party might have a policy or organizational convention again in the near future?
Yeah, we'll have those discussions, I think, as a party, and just see when we look to have another annual general meeting, I guess, and see when that might be. But we'll have those discussions with the party executive and make a decision from there. It's really up to them and executive council, I believe, to advise on that. And so I'll seek their advice.
Thank you very much, ma'am.
Freelance writer Anne.
Hello. Congratulations, Madam Premier. My one question is you've talked a little bit about how you'll reach out to the Westman region. Could you expand a little bit on how you will reach some of the other areas of Manitoba, northern, eastern?
I think we'll be going out and to the extent we can under the public health rules and so on during the pandemic. We will be reaching out to people all across this province. And not just Westman, but Southern Man and Northern Man and all over Manitoba. I've had the tremendous opportunity in the last couple of months to get out and talk to people all across this great province of ours. And it's really nice to be able to get together with Manitobans again. It's been difficult during the pandemic, certainly, to get together. And I think people were kind of ready to get together. And so we'll continue to listen to those Manitobans to see what some of the challenges are within their own communities. And we'll help them through this time.
Thank you.
From CKDM.
Good afternoon, Madam Premier, and congratulations. The Dauphin Correctional Facility was closed last year, and it's something that's still on people's minds. And Shelley Glover stated she'd reopen it if she became Premier, and I'm wondering if you had any plans to reopen it at all.
Yeah, I think, you know, obviously, there's been a decline in the population within our correctional facilities. And so, I mean, those decisions were made. These are tough decisions that are made and do have impacts on communities. And we obviously want to work with Dauphin and work with, those people in the community there to ensure that we find other ways that we can create economic development opportunities within those communities. And I think that there's, moving forward, I think there will be some opportunities in Dauphin. I look forward to having those discussions with the mayor and council there moving forward.
Thank you very much. I have no follow-up questions.
We now return to the News Conference Theater.
Just to follow up on what Skylar asked about the UMFA out there, they're asking specifically if you and your government will not get involved with negotiations. They're specifically asking that you don't get involved. Will you pledge that?
Yeah, like I think there's a process, Bart, that needs to take place, and you know, we're not directly the employer, and so that process needs to take place. We're going to respect that process.
And they want to know if they will be free of the wage cap.
So I'm in the process of, I know that this came across my desk this morning, that this might be a briefing that I would be getting later this week. So I want to wait to get that briefing before we make any further comments on this.
To follow up on that, Paul Ster, he had some pretty hard lines when it came to unions and negotiations and setting forth pretty strict mandates for raises or for negotiations. Are you going to have similar mandates in place? The 0.75, I think, was the popular one under Pallister. Is it going to be similar, or is there going to be similar restrictions placed on bargaining units?
So, again, I'll continue to get the briefing. I know that we're going to have a public sector compensation committee of cabinet meeting coming up shortly, and I'll listen to the folks around that table. But certainly, you know, I think we need to take more of a collaborative approach when it comes to labor in our province. And, you know, I'd like to work, you know, more closely with unions. And I know certainly on my own campaign, I had the opportunity to work with the firefighters union, Alex Forrest, as well as you know, the police, Winnipeg Police Association as well, and others. And I think we can have a better relationship moving forward than maybe we've seen in the past.
Will you appoint a labor minister?
Time will tell. It's certainly something that we would consider. We'll certainly consider that, Tom. I think everything's on the table right now when it comes to that. I'm really excited to have Don Leach here, and looking for some of his advice. He has extensive experience, moving back many years in the civil service, and so I want to make sure that I'm listening and seeking advice from those that have worked in governments in the past.
Pandemic or no pandemic, do you plan to increase ICU capacity in the province? Because
yes, we have to. And really the biggest challenge that we're faced with is obviously nurses and a shortage of nurses. So we look at the internationally educated nurses. I know that we were moving and making some progress with them to ensure that we get them, the necessary education that they need. We triage those. So as quickly as we can get some of these individuals in these positions, I think will be helpful. I think we also have to look at a very aggressive recruitment campaign to ensure that we bring nurses here to Manitoba. What that might look like, just stay tuned. I know we're looking at various options, and I know we'll keep you apprised of those things moving forward. But that's going to be critical, obviously, is getting, the shortage of nurses out there as well. So not just looking across the country, but around the world as to how we can attract people here. And obviously,
Do you think there were some errors made in the consolidation plan in terms of how it was executed? That errors that you think need to be fixed as they impacted ICUs, for example?
Well, I think in the middle of a pandemic, you're working with the best information that you can at the time, and I think there were some decisions, that were made that were tough decisions to move, nursing staff out of where they were and into ICU, and that was done primarily for the protection of Manitobans. So those decisions had to be made, but I think those are not long-term solutions to a significant challenge that we're faced with respect to a shortage of nurses. So,
in the consolidation plan, going back the last few years, there was a consolidation of hospitals. That consolidation, there were some errors made in how it was executed because it didn't seem that the system was well prepared for the pandemic. Obviously, no system is going to be built to respond to a pandemic, but there's been some analysis and observations made by those in the system that said there were some errors made in how the consolidation process played out, and that was magnified during the pandemic. Do you think there are some errors that were made during that process that need to be fixed?
Well, I think what I want to do is listen to those individuals and what they're saying and actually reach out to them and how do they think we could do it better. There's always things that we can learn from the past. I don't think we always get it right, and obviously want to work with those individuals who have lived experience through that time. How can we make it better? I will say, though, the consolidation and so on that did take place, you know, we got some pretty good results when it came to our wait times. And they were reduced significantly. So, and that was just prior to COVID. Now with COVID, it's, you know, there's other challenges, obviously. And we need to learn from, you know, how do we make things better and so that we've got a system that is working for Manitobans so it's there for them when they need it.
Speaking of recruitment, you mentioned toward the end of your speech about newcomers and immigration. And mm-hmm. Manitoba's immigration to this province went down to next to nothing during the pandemic. A little bit of a rebound somewhere else in Canada, not here. How specifically are you going to get more people to settle here internationally?
We're going to say, you know, I really just think we need to send a message that Manitoba is a great place to live and work and raise our families. But we will have this is one issue that I've heard loud and clear at pretty much everywhere in the province, not just in Winnipeg, but there's a labor shortage. There's no question. And so we need to ensure that immigration becomes a top priority. And I know also had an opportunity during the leadership race to meet with many new Canadian citizens with lived experience in our provincial nominee program. And I think that's another area that we need to focus on revamping that. Obviously, that was something that was brought in many, many years ago now under a previous Conservative government. But it needs... It needs a little revamping and overhauling, and I think we're going to listen, obviously, to those with lived experience who have gone through that process and see how we can make it much better, more efficient, and effective. But this is going to be, obviously, a critical path moving forward.
Even if it's revamped, it's up to the federal government to decide how many people Manitoba will get. Yeah. Do you have any indication that the ceiling will be raised for the number of nominees?
No, but that's, you know, these are the discussions. This is why we need to have sort of a collaborative approach with other levels of government. I mean, this is certainly something that I will raise as a priority for Manitoba with the Prime Minister when I have an opportunity to speak with him. And, you know, I mean, this absolutely has to be a priority. I think it is for other provinces as well. From what I'm hearing, and so certainly, you know, we'll try and get that to the top of the agenda.
You spent the campaign mostly trying to get the vote out. I think it's fair to say.
Yeah.
Identifying the vote, bringing it out. Hasn't been a lot of policy. Today's day one. When do you think you'll be able to come back to this room with some more clear policy directions for the next 2 years?
Yeah, so good question, Bart. And I think, you know, obviously I want to sit down with Cabinet and Caucus and you know, not just collectively, but also individually as well and get their ideas. What are they hearing out there? I think we haven't had an opportunity to do that for a long time. And this is, we're going to set a new course, a new direction. I think, you know, we will come out with a throne speech, you know, in November and probably looking at fairly high level in terms of direction and vision. And then, you know, after that, looking at, you know, what are the priority areas based on what we're hearing in our communities out there. And so that's certainly the approach that I will take.
The revamped Bill 64, will there be a new I'm not saying it'll be called 64, but will there be a new bill on improving education in this province? Will something come forward?
Again, you know, I think the important thing here is that we need to be empowering our ministers to do their jobs. And if there's something that they feel that would be a priority to bring forward, then we'll look at that. But we'll look at it as a cabinet and a caucus to see if it's something that, you know, and we'll talk to Manitobans about it as well. I mean, what happened with 64 is that it came together and really, certainly on that governance side of things, it was never canvassed out there in the public. And so, you know, when we're all hearing the same thing out there, that this is something that Manitobans really don't want, you know, we need to be listening to Manitobans. And so that's obviously the approach that we'll take moving forward with 64 and with other bills as well.
Do you still see a role for elected school boards in the future?
You know what? I'll see what Manitobans want, Tom. I mean, I don't see it one way or the other. I think we can make some changes. You know, again, I think it's important that we go back and listen to those who are working within the system, get their advice, but really look to parents as well to see what kind of a system that they want for their kids. Obviously, our focus needs to be on better education for our kids. We cannot take our eye off that. And so that will be our focus moving forward in education, certainly.
You're doing a lot of listening, but do you have any ideas? Like, tell us some of your ideas.
Well, You know what? But Manitobans haven't been listened to for a while, so it's something that Manitobans really want, I'm going to tell you. But, you know, I've already talked about, you know, needing and the importance of really tackling our surgical and diagnostic backlogs in healthcare. It's definitely a priority for Manitobans. And also looking at ways to boost our economy. We need to get those businesses who have been closed back up and running at 100% capacity. And those businesses that are looking to expand, we want them to be expanding here in Manitoba. So what are the programs and the policies and so on that we need to change? We'll be looking at all of those things and putting together a package that I believe will eventually be able to help Manitobans, those businesses get back up and running so we can start growing our economy and obviously be able to have the money to be able, you know, as we grow our economy, to be able to pay for healthcare, education, social services.
Do you see that there's a great challenge in front of you to regain the trust of Manitobans between now and the next election?
I do. Yeah, it's a significant challenge. And but we're ready to take it on. And I'm, you know, we're starting on the ground running right away. Tomorrow we'll have those discussions in Cabinet and Caucus and see how can we do that. How can we start to earn the trust of Manitobans? It's going to be absolutely critical over the course of the next couple of years.
You have a land acknowledgement today. Will there be a land acknowledgement when the House resumes?
We'll have those discussions and we'll let you know.
Yes. Well, this news conference is taking place here in 25 minutes. Kevin Chevalier will be speaking about Brad Aldridge, the Chicago Blackhawks, and the sexual assault scandal that's enveloped the NHL. As the leader of the province, would you have any advice for Mark Chipman, Kevin Chevalier, for the Winnipeg Jets?
I'm going to wait to see what they have to say in their conference. You know, I mean, this is obviously something that I need to listen and hear from them as to where this is at. And so I don't have enough information right now to be able to make that, you know, to make a comment on that. But certainly we'll see what they have to say at their conference. I believe that's coming up fairly soon.
You are the
Thanks, guys.